All right, well, energy prices are going up once again. Victoria bracing for the biggest jump, expecting a 30% rise on already inflated bills. The move has angered many, with families and businesses suffering while energy giants churn profits. Joining us from Melbourne is Energy Local's founder Adrian Merrick and local business owner Chris Cameron. Thank you both so much for your time. Adrian, I want to start with you. Let's take a quick look at this. This just gives us a bit of an idea of how much more Australians are paying for their energy prices. We will get that graphic up soon. But you can see in Victoria, it's an extra $426 expected, and that's on top of what the price rises have been in the past couple of years. This is going to infuriate so many people. How on earth are we going to manage this?
Good morning. And it should infuriate people. Infuriates us as well. We see little justification in a country that has such incredible access to natural resources that because there's been a conflict on the other side of the world, suddenly we're punishing customers here. And this is really driven by the wholesale market. Most of the other changes in prices that make up an energy bill are relatively immaterial compared to this. But wholesale energy prices are really out of control, frankly. Yeah. And this is driven by issues with fuel supply, because a lot of coal and gas is going overseas and there's not enough to run the power stations that we have here.
Well, that's right. What you mentioned there, Adrian, is that there is a myriad of problems here. But I guess when you look at it more domestically, I mean, we're shutting down the gas industry without really having the renewables up and ready to sort of make that shortfall. It's cut before the horse stuff here, isn't it?
Yeah, so look, gas is not the future, right? We get that, and we spend a lot of time working on renewables in our business and small-scale stuff that is close to customers and where they use power. But in the short term, we need gas. And in the short term, as unpopular as it is to some people, we also need coal. It's part of the mix to get us through to a point where there is this more sustainable future. Now, there are a bunch of renewable projects that are held up. We don't have the transmission network to support the new renewables in the locations that they're going as yet. So in the short term, really important that we have and make sure at a policy level that the power stations that need fuel can access it, and they can access it, and the suppliers of that fuel are willing to sell it at prices that will generate affordable power.
Chris, I want to bring you in because we know that the impact on households is already significant, but when it comes to small business, it's even greater. I mean, you run a small business in Melbourne's northeast. How are you going to cope with this?
Yeah, look, it's going to be difficult. I mean, we're in obviously an industry that is a heavy user of power. So this could really put between $7,000 to $15,000 a year on our bill at our current production rate. So it's going to be really difficult in the short term. Hopefully the long term it sort of settles out, but these costs are just going to get passed on to our customers, unfortunately.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. What happens when you do pass the costs on to the customer? Are you hoping that they'll just be able to afford it, or are they going to desert you?
Oh, I hope they can afford it, but the reality is with interest rates going up, cost of living going up, all of the other issues we've got throughout Australia at the moment, that it probably will lead to less people through our doors, which has then a flow-on effect to our staff. You know, we've got about 15 casuals and 7 full-times. That's going to make it difficult for them to support their families and their lifestyle. So it'll become a cycle.
The government, the federal government, has attempted to try and remedy this. It's yet to be clear just how much of an impact it will actually have. What more do you need to stay afloat?
Well, we probably don't have enough time to talk about all of the things that we need, but start by, I guess, small businesses especially getting solar. I know that there's grants available and things like that. However, it still is a $40,000 outlay for someone like me. So making that much more obtainable and achievable would be a start. I think there are other measures in place for our industry specifically, sustainable energy, things like that. You know, not making privatisation of all power and things like that will make a big difference.
Yeah, Chris, Adrian, thanks so much for your time. It's certainly complex, but the government does need to step in here and help you guys out. Appreciate your time. Thanks.
Yeah, there's a bit on, isn't there? Energy debt relief is one of the main calls from the Australian Council of Social Services today, pushing the federal government for more cost of living assistance. CEO Cassandra Goldie joins us now. Cassandra, good morning to you. I mean, when you look at July 1 of this year, there are going to be people heading towards a cliff, both personally with the amount of power bills going up. I mean, it's horrendous. And then add small business to that. $1,500 extra. I mean, how are we possibly going to cope?
I know. Well, look, going into this, we've already got 3 million people living in poverty, so that's 1 in 8 people, including 1 in 6 children. And every day we are hearing those stories, people going without food, parents pretending they're eating when they're not because they want their kids to get the food, people not able to afford the essential medicines, and people giving up their rental property because the landlord wants a big increase, they can't afford it, and they end up sleeping in cars and in parks. That's where we're at as a country, and it shouldn't be where we are.
Rents going up, as you rightly point out. Mortgages definitely going up. And then you've got power on top of this, as well as everyday living expenses. What are you asking for?
Well, the first thing is for people on the lowest incomes. We have to put people on the lowest incomes at the front of this budget. I mean, it's the first big budget from the Albanese government. They said coming in that they would leave nobody behind. Well, people who can't afford to feed themselves should be at the front. Carl, we need to get rid of those stage three tax cuts. I mean, they will be delivering $9,000 per year to people on 200,000 plus. These are choices we're making. We say get rid of those and invest that money in the cost of living relief for people who are really desperate.
There's no account there is an account for how much it's going to cost to protect this country, but I would imagine for a lot of people out there seeing the price of subs when they can't get $10 or more support, it's pretty tough.
Well, exactly. I mean, the community, this is the community debate, isn't it? You know, politicians follow community now. That's where we're at. The Treasurer says he wants a debate about revenue. We agree. If we want to be investing in defence and also protecting people from the cost of living crisis and the challenges we face, like climate change, we can't afford to be the ninth lowest overall in terms of our tax and revenue take amongst the 36 wealthiest countries in the world. We need to fix that. Aged care workers today, they've woken up going, how do I pay my energy bill? Well, we need to deliver that pay rise that they desperately
and
need.
And John Keogh in the AFR this morning says we'll need 50 more snowy hydro projects in order to handle the amount of power that we're going to need by 2050.
Yeah, well, we've lost a decade on this, and it's time for us to get more renewables into the system. It's the cheapest energy supply. But in the meantime, we want the government to provide energy debt relief for people to keep their lights on.
Good on you. Nice to see you, Cassandra.
Thanks.
Sarah. Welcome back. Australians are bracing for skyrocketing power prices this morning. Have a look at this. $426 more in Victoria and a similar rise in regional Queensland. This is coming your way. New South Wales, $463. And in South Australia, $401. It's a lot on top of already growing expenses. Joining us to discuss, Independent MP Di Lee from Smithfield in Sydney's West and Neil Breen from 4BC in Brizzy. Good morning, guys. Nice to see you, Di. These are major increases, especially being hard felt and predicted to rise quite considerably in your neck of the woods.
Look, Carl, look, I cannot obviously... I sound like I'm repeating myself, but from the start when I got elected, I have brought the issue of the cost of living here in southwest Sydney, and I have no doubt across Australia, how that's going to impact communities and families struggling really to meet, put food on the table, paying petrol prices, and of course now energy prices. So I've been really at the heels of the government saying do something about it now. And of course in December, the government did say that they're going to work in bringing the electricity prices down, but obviously it's not happening. Honestly, it's just really frustrating, really.
Di, you were elected to your seat to try and enact that change. It becomes a problem for you if nothing is done, right?
Oh, look, it doesn't become a problem for me. I think it's going to become a problem for the government because they did promise to bring down electricity prices. The community knows that I have been at the heels of the government to really get them to look at other measures, in terms of providing short-term relief for our community. So I have had put forward quite a few short-term measures, but the government have not agreed to them.
Breeny, John Keogh in the Fin Review this morning writes pretty eloquently about the problems that we were going to face in the next 10 years, because we've gone renewables before, we've done a phasing out of the traditional forms of energy production. And it's clear to everyone now that we may have got that balance wrong. But in regional parts of Queensland this morning, when they see that bill on July 1, $400 more, they're going to be filthy.
Particularly, Carl, because they only have one provider in regional Queensland, and that's a real failing of only one government, really, the Labor government in Queensland. They can't blame Campbell Newman for that one. He was only in power for 3 years, and Labor's been in power for 31 of the last 35 years. This whole situation is a great failing of our society, Carl. We know there's a climate emergency around the globe, and we're not going to get into an ideological battle over that. But if we want to move to renewables, it had to be done in a better way, not in a way where we live in one of the most resource-rich nations in the world, where we send uranium and coal and gas overseas, yet we're jamming people in our own nation. Think of pensioners. Think of young families struggling. Interest rates, grocery bills, these power prices. And Labor got elected saying, oh, we'll take $275 off your bill. It was absolutely fraudulent. And it's a great shame on the whole nation. What about small businesses, Carl?
I know.
Going to the wall? What about employment?
Well,
there's no answers.
Breeny, small businesses, look at this. And, Di, this is going to affect people in your neck of the woods again. A lot of them are coming off 2% loans onto 5% in the next couple of months. And then look what they're facing. I mean, look at Victoria, $1,700 more. In regional Queensland, $500. Oh, you can't find it. Anyway, let's move on.